So if you came expecting to hear from the Lord today, that's what you're going to get. I say it every week. If you don't come with an expectation, you don't receive nothing. But if you woke up this morning and you said, I am expecting to hear from God this morning when I get into the house of the Lord, then I'm telling you right now, you just get ready. Thank you. When no one else will do it, the First Lady will support. Amen. Let me get serious for a minute, though. The church is in need for revival. The church is in need for revival. We have never needed the power and the anointing of God than we need right now in this nation, in our church, in our homes, and all these things round up in one, I guess you could say. We need it, beloved. We need it. And so today I have a message called Old Stone. And as Pastor Jennifer already said, God's going to do a new thing today. As long as you are willing to be used by Him. God is going to build a new wall today for some of you that's been torn down in your life. The question is will you be a part of what God's wanting to do? You've got to be ready to be a part of what He wants to do. Amen. Well, look, we're going to jump into this. I got my glasses out. Let's stand one more time. I know you've been standing for me in a minute, but let's stand for the reading of God's Word. We're going to be in Nehemiah, chapter 1. And I'm going to read the first four verses there. Hallelujah. So the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, it came to pass in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came with me from Judah, and I asked him concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. They said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying for the God of heaven. Father, I thank you today, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Father, for all your many blessings that you have poured out upon us. I thank you today, my Savior, that you will do something in this place. I pray, Lord, right now that you will just touch every heart and open their minds to what you would have to speak to them today, God. I ask you, Lord, today to let the people rise up in this house and say, use me, Lord, here I am. Use me for your glory, God. Bring revival into me, oh God, first. I ask for today, Lord, that set a fire deep inside of everybody in this room this morning, God. I pray today, Father, for a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit in me. Anoint my lips. To preach and teach your word. Anoint the ears to hear. The hearts to receive. Master, may none of us leave this place the same way that we walked in today. May we be radically changed for Jesus Christ. Ready to spread a fire throughout Forsyth. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Give God one more hand clap. Praise God. Look, turn around and give somebody a high five. Say, old stones, get ready. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Nehemiah here. It's kind of a representation of the Holy Spirit. His name means comforter. And Nehemiah was grieved that the walls of Jerusalem had been broken down. And Nehemiah can also represent here any believer who is in harmony with the will and the purpose and desire of the Holy Spirit for the church. The wall represents the standard that is set. It represents the integrity. It represents the strength. And it represents the character. And it might even represent the power of the church. So let's look at something about a wall this morning. A wall does a couple of
something that can get in harm me. But also a wall keeps a few things out as well and protects. It preserves and keeps safe. It keeps the right things in and protects them and keeps the bad things out. So I just want to look at something for a minute. Look at Moses for a moment. Moses' mother placed him into a little basket, right? Before she put him into the Nile River. And before she put the basket down into the river, she took and built the basket and she pitched it within an hour. I mean, she put a sack of serum, I guess you'd say, like a tar on the outside of this thing. And she did that to keep the water out from the basket. She put that on the outside to protect the little baby that was inside. Before she could ever put it into the water, she had to make sure it was same thing when he built the ark. He took and built the ark and put all the wood and he put this same thing on the outside of it and on the inside of it because he was trying to keep his family safe. He was trying to keep the animals safe from the water that was outside because he didn't know how much water was coming. You got to understand, beloved, at this time it ain't never rained on earth. Amen. Everything got water from the dew of the earth. And so he don't know how much rain is coming, so he makes sure that this thing is properly prepared. It's necessary to make it waterproof. And so now Nehemiah here is talking about the walls that have been burnt down. And Nehemiah is no doubt a book about revival. It's about restoration and bringing the glory of God back to the church. It starts with an honest assessment of the brokenness and the hopelessness and the despair of people who have lost their faith. People in the church have accepted their situation and their condition as terminal. In other words, they have started to give up. They have begun to give up. They have no hope. They have no expectation for change. They couldn't see past the present dilemma that they're in. All they could see was their current situation and circumstance that was before them. Somebody's got to listen today. You got to hear what the Spirit's saying. You got to grab this thing in the atmosphere. You've been looking at some situations that have been labeled terminal in your life. The devil has been telling you that it's terminal and you need to give up. The doctor's told you it's terminal and there's not much hope for you. Maybe the lawyer's told you you don't need to worry about it anymore. It's lost. Your enemies are telling you, man, it's terminal. Your best friends are telling you, you might as well give up. Your loved ones are telling you the same thing. Beloved, before you know it, you're going to start to agree with them. You're looking at a broken down wall, and it looks hopeless. It looks like it's beyond. It looks like it's beyond repair. But stop looking through the eyes of the flesh. And start looking through the eyes of the Spirit. Stop listening to what the world is saying about you. Start listening to the one who knows about you. I know you can't see how God could ever put your marriage back together, but let me tell you something. He's already doing it if you allow him to. You can't see how God would ever heal you of that disease, but he's doing it if you allow him to. You can't see how the ministry could ever be restored, but he's doing it if you allow him to. You can't see how you're going to get out of debt, but your finances are already on the up if you just allow him to. You can't see how that prodigal son or daughter's coming back to the church, but he's already doing it if you allow him to. You can't see how God is breaking the addictions on your life. He's already doing it if you allow him to. You can't see how the curses are being broken over your life. He's breaking them if you allow him to. But you got to let him allow it. You got to let him do these things in your life. You got to start listening and start walking out some things. Oh, the problem with the church is we let everybody speak into our life. With the Holy Spirit. We listen to everybody else. We listen to all the naysayers and all the wrongdoers and all the worldly people. And we won't listen to people in the church. And we won't listen to godly people. What have we done? There were some people in the Bible in the same situation. They were in the wilderness dying of thirst. There was a prophet that came along and he said, dig some ditches. Somebody look at somebody and say, dig a ditch. Somebody say, dig a ditch. Look at the other one say, dig a ditch. Second Kings 3:16, same thing he said, thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. For thus saith the Lord, ye shall not see wind, neither shall you see rain, yet that valley shall be filled with water. All that ye may drink, O ye and your cattle and your beast. The prophet's telling me, he said, you ain't going to see it coming. You won't see the wind. You won't hear the rain. Wait a minute, hold on. But the valley's going to be full of water. You may not see the end of that situation that you're going through, but let me tell you something. Listen to the wind this morning, because the Holy Spirit says it's coming your way. It's coming your way. If you grab a hold of what the Spirit of God is saying, he's sending the rain. Somebody needs to start digging in some ditches. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm digging ditches.
I'm
telling you right now, I'm starting to dig some ditches.
If you don't stay up, you're going to get flooded by my ditches.
When they woke up the next morning, water had came from the way of Adam, and the country was filled with water. Every ditch was filled with water.
Look, God don't ask you to do nothing.
Don't ask you something about nothing.
He's going to reward you.
He's going to reward you. Now you see what is impossible here with man is not impossible with God. See, I know right now you can't see how God's going to do it. It looks like a dead, dry hand. You can't see the end of it. You can't see the light. But I'm telling you this morning, God is fixing to send the water. The water is coming. And you better grab your pail. You better grab your bucket. You might ought to grab your wheelbarrow. Whatever you need to grab, because God's fixing to start filling it up on you today. You might even need to start digging a few more ditches.
Yes.
Because God wants to fill them up. God wants to fill them up this morning. He's getting ready to send the rain in this place this morning. He's getting ready to send a surplus, an abundance of what you need this morning. You just need to be ready to hold on and grab what he's sending your way. The water he's sending may be for your healing and your body, so you better have a bucket ready to catch that thing and an ear to hear it coming. It might be deliverance for your sons and daughters. You better have an ear to hear it this morning. It might be for restoration in your marriage. You better grab a hold of it. It might be for breakthrough in your finances. But you better be able to hold it. I'm telling you right now, every filthy lie that the enemy has spoken over your life is fixing to be washed off by the rain. If you just hear the end,
hear what the Spirit's saying.
Cast that enemy out of your mind. I don't know what it is for you, but it's coming. Healing is on the way.
Just
grab it. Miracles are on the way. Don't wait any longer. Like she said, like Pastor Denver said this morning, just because it's happening over there, just because it was doing nowhere, don't exclude us, Lord. Don't exclude us, Lord. We're digging some ditches, God. We're ready for the rain. We're ready to be poured out right here in this place. We're ready to see the miracle signs and wonders take place in this house right here, God. Use us, oh Lord.
Use us.
Oh. Your deliverance is on the way. You just don't know it. Quit listening to the world that says you can't go or come. Quit listening to those around you to say you'll never be better than that. Listen to the Father this morning. I'm telling you, he's got a word for you today. And if you just hold on and wait, it's on the way. Somebody say it's on the way. Hallelujah. Your Nehemiah is on the way. Oh, the Holy Ghost has come on with the answer. And I don't know what it looks like for you, but I just know the Lord told me today it's coming for somebody. You need to believe and receive what the Spirit is trying to tell you this morning, and don't accept what the enemy's report looks like. Don't even accept the report of your own thought. We have been in this world so long that we have let it just infiltrate our mind with things, and every time something starts to look up for the Lord, the next thing we know, the enemy pops a thought in your head and says, you ain't good enough. You can't do this. You can't do that. I'm telling you, better cast that devil out of your mindset. Get him out of your head. No. Don't believe the world any longer. Believe God's report. And God told me to come this morning and have you dig a ditch so he can send the rain to your house. Don't give up in the middle of a drought any longer. Just believe that the rain is coming and you got to have it. Break the shovel out of that closet that you got to put up in and start digging in some hard ground. Seeds don't bear fruit when you throw it on the concrete.
You gotta till the ground.
Beloved, we always say we want revival. We want revival. We want revival. What are we doing to prepare for it? If I want some apples, I gotta plant some apple trees. Amen. Amen. If I want some pecans, I got to get some pecan trees out there. I said that last time I was a pecan guy. My wife said that.
My wife said that.
Here, geez, that one recorded, will you? That one recorded. That might have hurt me in my, redneck community there.
Redneck community there.
But if you want pecans, you got to plant pecans.
We got to plant pecans.
Amen.
Amen.
If we want revival, beloved, we got to till the ground and make it ready for revival.
Ready for revival.
It's time that we wake up. In the middle of our storm, or in the middle of our desert, we got to sit here and say, God, no, I'm going to dig a few ditches right here, right in the middle of where I'm at. Let me tell you something. There was three boys that went into the fiery furnace, and I know when they looked in there, he said, I don't know what's taking place in there, but I see them dancing around in there. Somebody needs to praise God right in the middle of that fiery furnace, because let me tell you something. They could have been devoured, but they said, if we shall go in, our God will go with us. But if not, No more devil.
No more devil.
No more devil. trying to make you believe that evil has triumphed over everything. He's trying to make the false religion seem right, that homosexuality and lust is okay, that perversion and idolatry are doing everything. The devil would have us believe that it's all useless and hopeless. That our efforts to move forward
are useless.
But I don't care, devil, what you think.
I'm digging a ditch.
He'd have us believe that even when I get up here and preach it, it ain't doing nothing to nobody. That the preaching of the cross and the blood of Jesus was only for a certain time. That preaching about godliness and holiness and purity and truth and sanctification, all these things are outdated and powerless. But devil, I'm digging a ditch today to catch my rain and let you know that you ain't nothing but a liar. The devil is a liar.
Exactly where it got quiet in the first service.
I should have marked it. I could have skipped it. But apparently the Holy Ghost wants me here. It's going to take some work. We can have revival, and it's close. I'm telling you, if you've been a part of this place for the last 5 weeks, we're on it right now. I'm telling you, I feel like I'm right here like this. I'm just got one foot in. I'm telling you, we're right on the edge of revival.
Take some work.
We can have mighty moves of God and get everything started. And yes, we can. The walls can be rebuilt around us. But it's going to take a little bit of work on your part. Revival is not some random act of grace that just falls from the sky and falls on the people from time to time. No, revival is the product, the fruit, the cooperative effect of the Spirit of God and the people leaking up in unity. The Holy Spirit wants to revive the wall. We ain't waiting on the Holy Spirit. He's waiting on us. Nehemiah works with God's people to accomplish his purpose. His revival never happens by accident. Revival begins when there's a desire, when there's change. And it's got to start inside of you. Revival begins when we're able to see and admit we have lost. We see what's been broken down. Choose to no longer accept, what is normal. The world makes us believe that everything's normal. You can sin and it's normal. Homosexuality, lifestyle, it's normal. Broken homes and divorces, it's all normal. Sickness and disease, it's normal. Idolatry, perversion, it's all normal. It's not normal, beloved. The Word of God stands against it, and it is not normal. And I don't care who I offend. Laying aside every fleshly desire and repenting, and turning. turning from our wicked ways, crying out to God.
Crying out to God.
And God answering.
God answering.
We can have revival whenever and wherever we are willing to pay the price and do the work.
And do the work.
Revival does not be
Bible does not begin
when the world is ready.
When the world is ready.
And it doesn't begin with the
it
world.
Doesn't begin with the world.
We can't expect the world to get better.
The world to get better
until the church gets right.
The church gets right.
Too many churches let them bring sense to the house.
Let them bring sense to the house now.
Too many compromises.
Too many compromises taking place.
In the religious scene or in the church scene
or in the church.
But 2 Chronicles 7:14 says that my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. That's how revival starts, beloved. When the people of God say enough is enough. I'm going to pray. I'm going to fast. I'm going to believe. I'm going to turn from every wicked desire that I have and keep my eyes focused on the Lord. And revival's going to start inside of my heart. Because when it can start inside of my heart, it can start inside this church. But it's got to start inside first.
It's got to start inside
first. It begins with every child of God.
Builds the walls of their own
walls.
The walls of honesty,
walls
and integrity, and righteousness.
It begins at the altar of repentance and turning
away from
everything
that the world would have you desire.
Listen to the scripture here. Sanballat and Tobiah.
They tried to discourage
the man of God and the work. And it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah heard it, he built the wall. He was wrong to great indignation and mocked the Jews.
He said, even that
said,
which
they
build, if a fox knoweth,
he shall break it down.
Break it down.
Their stone wall.
Their stone wall.
But you got to understand something.
He's trying to provoke some things.
The devil's been provoking a few people.
He's been ridiculed.
He's been
criticized.
He's been
humiliating.
He's been demoralizing.
Let me tell you something.
There's a whole work in this story right here.
In verse 2,
if we go back, it says,
what do these people choose?
Will they fortify themselves?
Will they sacrifice?
Will they make an end of the day?
And then he says,
they will revive the stones out of the heap of the rubbish which are burned.
Some of you got some piles of heaps around you, but let me tell you something.
God said, give me them stones.
I'm fixing to build a wall up.
I'm fixing to bring revival back inside of.
I just need to get them stones that are over here and bring them back up.
You thought they was just old stones, but God said,
there's stones I can revive.
He said, I can revive.
He said, I can revive.
He says they can do anything with these old burnt stones piled up in the trash.
Really, what he's saying is you can't do anything with this trash.
With this trash.
You can't build anything with these old
burnt stones.
He's trying to discourage them, and that's what the devil does to you.
You ain't good enough.
What about your past?
What about your past?
What about what you did last?
What about what you did last?
What about you? What you said?
What about you?
What about this?
What about this?
What about this? What about this?
Let me tell you something. When I read this right here,
something inside me.
Because I could hear the devil talking,
and through his words,
I could hear the devil saying to
so many people
that you're no good anymore.
That you're all burned up and used up.
You're all messed up.
You've been all broken up.
You've been abused and you've been a drug addict.
You may have been a homosexual.
You cheated on your wife.
You failed the ministry.
You're nobody.
You're rubbish,
trash,
good for nothing. Nobody wants you.
But I came to tell you, God said,
I can use that old rugged pile of stone
and I can build a new wall right up.
Somebody just needs to believe it this morning.
Somebody's got to believe it.
Somebody's got to believe it.
Oh,
hallelujah.
When you hear that voice of the devil,
you got to remember
there's another voice speaking.
There's the voice of Nehemiah,
the Holy Spirit,
saying,
I want these old burnt stones,
but I want them all piled up.
The ones that are in the trash,
bring them to me.
Bring them to me.
The ones that everybody threw to the side.
Bring them back to me.
Bring them back to me.
Oh, the ones that didn't fit in.
The ones that didn't fit in.
Bring it back to me.
Bring it back to me.
The ones that are carrying scars around.
Bring it back to me.
Bring it back to
the ones that have track marks
going up the horns.
Bring them back to me.
Bring them back.
Oh, the ones that have been rejected by the religion.
Bring them back to me.
Bring the outcasts of society.
The ones that feel like a leper that's untouchable.
Bring them back to me.
Oh,
I'm going to do exactly what they said I couldn't do.
I'm going to take them burst on.
And God says he's going to
build a new wall.
Build a new wall.
use to step up for what's right. 1 Corinthians 6, 9-11 says, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners, shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. And by the Spirit of God, you have been set free this morning. We are no longer those that I read about any longer. You are a free man or woman of God, because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And I'm not labeling it. I'm not labeling anymore by my past situation or circumstances. I'm only labeled by where I'm going and where I'm going this morning. Is I'm about to dig some ditches in this house. Oh, hallelujah. Because the rain is coming. The rain is coming. The rain is coming. We just got to dig some ditches.
I need you.
don't need the perfect.
I don't need the perfect.
This is what I want to build my church with. I'll take the burnt stones, and build the new wall. I don't care where you came from in this life. Or where you've been or what you've been going in or what you've been going through. The Bible tells me in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. And behold, all things. There's a spirit of revival. It's in precise source. And God is pouring out his spirit. And I don't know in the ways that we don't like sometimes. He's going to be talking to you. He's going to be stepping on your toes. But it's just because he wants to use you to build the walls so revival can come. There's signs and wonders and miracles being poured out even in this moment. But it's not going to happen everywhere. They're going to be the churches that are flooded with the glory of God. And they're going to be known as hot spots for revival. When you talk to your church friends, you need to tell them to look up.
You need to tell them to look up
the cell tower in God's book. Tap into the Wi-Fi for all
church.
Miracles are going to start happening. Healings are going to start happening. Deliverance is going to start happening. How you say it, Pastor? Because the Bible says I can speak those things not as though they are, and then they go away. I had a grandmama that said I'd preach the word of God, and she spoke it into the atmosphere. When I said it never happened, she said you're going to preach. She spoke it into the atmosphere. Some of you need to speak some things over your life this morning.
Sure, you're living right for the Lord.
I want everybody to this morning. You came this morning. But it was come. You were sitting here to have an encounter with God.
An encounter with God.
The Bible tells me that.
The Bible tells me that
if He'd be lifted up, He'd draw all men to Him.
Draw all men to Him.
And we have lifted Him up in praise and worship,
praise
and worship the Word of God.
The Word of God.
So if you're here this morning, they all have every head, by all have
every
head,
by all have every closed.
If you're here today and you stay
here today,
Pastor, you've been short, been yelling a lot, scream yelling a lot. In the middle of all that, the Lord has spoken to my heart. And I'm not living right.
And I'm not living right.
I'm not doing some things right.
I'm not doing some things right.
And I need some walls
rebuilt
in my life. I need to know Jesus.
To know Jesus.
Like you know.
Like you know.
If you're here today and you say, I'm here, the Lord of my life.
I need to repent.
I need to repent. Maybe you used to walk with the Lord.
You used to walk with the Lord.
You walked away for a little while. But you're here this morning, I'm going to count to three. Nobody's looking around. I'm not going to call you out.
I'm not going to call
anything
you out.
Like that.
Anything like that.
I just want to make sure you leave here knowing the Lord is your Savior.
The Lord is your Savior.
If you're here today and that's you,
we're
count
to
three. Just simply lift your hand.
1, 2, 3,
lift your hand.
1, 2, 3, lift your hand.
Is anybody in this place? I see your hand.
I see your hand.
You can put it in. This is what we're going to do, beloved. What we're going to do, we're going to say a prayer together.
We're going to say
everybody in here.
Everybody in here.
Not going to single anybody out.
We're going to single anybody out.
Gonna say a prayer and then we're gonna rejoice because the Bible tells me that the angels in heaven rejoice when just
one soul comes.
So today we're gonna say a prayer. Repeat after me, say
Father,
in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I ask you today.
I ask you today.
Forgive me of my sins.
Forgive me of my sins.
Cleanse me and wash me.
Cleanse me and wash me.
I ask you today.
I ask you today.
To be my Father.
To be my Father.
Let me be your child.
Let me be your child.
I confess with my mouth.
Confess with my mouth.
And believe in my heart,
and believe in my heart,
that you died for me,
that you died for me.
So today,
by faith,
I confess you
as my Lord and Savior,
as my Lord and Savior.
In Jesus' name,
Amen. 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 Give God a hand clap of praise
for that right there.